This is the story of how wondering about this led to a breakthrough in designing one of these. It's fascinating how math problems explored just for fun sometimes turn out to have very practical applications. For example, abstract algebra and number theory, fields developed centuries ago without any immediate use in mind, now underpin the encryption systems that keep our internet secure. But I never thought something like that would happen to me. A math problem I worked on purely for fun turned out to provide insight that helped solve challenges engineers were facing with solar arrays for satellites. Before we dive into the math, we have some exciting news. The Math the World Shopify store is live. You can find it through our YouTube channel or by visiting mattheworld.byu.edu. Your support means the world to us. And now you can contribute by purchasing merch like t-shirts, sweatshirts, stickers, nerd helmets, and curated donation merch packages. And all profits go directly to supporting and growing this channel. We're also open to sponsorships. If you work for a company that would like to sponsor our videos, or you happen to be independently wealthy and you'd like to donate to our mission of showcasing how math solves real-world problems, please email us at mattheworld@byu.edu. Now, let's talk math and how a tie-dyed t-shirt inspired a better satellite solar array. Well, at a family reunion many years ago, we made several tie-dyed t-shirts for the upcoming 4th of July holiday. When I got back to campus in the fall, I noticed something that I hadn't before, that every single spiral tie-dyed t-shirt has the same spiral. What do I mean by that? I mean, you could take a spiral curve from one shirt, and it would match up with about any other tie-dyed t-shirt. So I started to wonder why. Why do they all have the same spiral? And what spiral is it? Well, first, you need to know a little bit about the process of making tie-dyed shirts. Let's look at how a classic tie-dyed t-shirt is made. You twist the shirt from the center into a disc, secure it with rubber bands, dye the individual sections, and let it sit in a bag for a day before washing and admiring your beautiful work. When the shirt's untwisted, you can see the colorful spiral formed from the color wedges. Now we can actually answer one of my main questions. Why are all of the spirals on tie-dyed t-shirts the same spiral? It's because shirt materials are similar in thickness, and when they're twisted up, the disc ends up being about the same thickness every time. The thickness of the material and the thickness of the disc determines what spiral you end up with. To make a tight spiral that grows slowly, you would need to get a very thin material shirt and twist it up into a thicker disc. There are actually two spirals that are important for us to consider: the spiral formed when we twist the shirt into a disc, and the spiral design seen after dyeing and untwisting the shirt. I thought I had a better chance of finding the equation of the disc spiral before finding the equation of the dyed spiral we see. So how could I go about finding out what spiral it is? When a mathematician or scientist or engineer bumps into a situation like this that they want to understand mathematically, they build a mathematical model based on reasonable assumptions and the features of the situation. So I started to think about what features I have to work with and what assumptions would be reasonable. I had a natural center to work with, so I assumed to model the curve as a polar curve. A polar curve is one that takes in an angle and gives out the radius or distance from the center. The angle is usually called theta and is the angle from this horizontal axis, and the radius, r, is the length from the center to the curve. So one way to think about this problem is that I'm trying to find the formula that traces out the spiral as the angle increases. But I need more to go on than that to find the formula. One assumption that I thought would be reasonable was about the shrinking factor going from the shirt to the disc. The points on the shirt all get pulled in closer to the center. I thought it would be reasonable to assume that the shrinking was proportional, so points that are two or three times as far out on the shirt ended up two or three times out on the disc. Let's call that ratio k. I tried to find k by twisting up one of my shirts, and it looked like points on the shirt were pulled toward the center by a factor of about 1/4. So points that start 8 inches or 20 centimeters from the center end up being 2 inches or 5 centimeters from the center in the disc. Another assumption that I thought would be reasonable was that the length along the spoke lines, which is a segment from the center of the shirt to another point on the shirt, are still the same length along the curve when they're twisted into a disc. There isn't a lot of stretching or compressing in the directions of these lines when the shirt is twisted up, so they still should be the same length. This turns out to be an assumption that really helps me get somewhere mathematically. Luckily, lengths are something that have been studied in polar curves, so I could use this polar arc length equation. If you haven't had calculus, it can look scary. And if you have had calculus, it still probably looks scary. The length depends on the value of the polar curve and the derivative of the curve. And it involves an integral, which we can think of as adding up lengths of tiny pieces of the line to get the total arc length of the curve. With this formula and assumptions, I could connect the length of three things. The distance along this spoke, d, the distance along this spiral, also d, and the distance from the center, which is k times d. The distance d can be found by using the arc length integral, but it can also be found by the shrinking factor. The distance from the center to the endpoint of the spiral is k times d, but it is also r of theta. So if we divide r of theta by k, we get d. So now we can equate the two expressions we have for d and see if that gets us something we can work with. Well, this is kind of a funky equation. This may be different than equations you've worked with in math for a couple of reasons. First, we have this integral to work with in an equation. It would be nice to eliminate that somehow. Second, we're trying to solve for a function. We want to know what r of theta is. And usually we're solving equations for an unknown value, but here it's an unknown function. Equations with unknown functions and derivatives of that function are called differential equations. And differential equations are so valuable at solving real-world problems that they are the basis of the field of applied mathematics. I can eliminate the integral by using a derivative and the fundamental theorem of calculus. I take the derivative of both sides and end up with r prime of theta divided by k on the left, and using the fundamental theorem of calculus, I end up with this square root expression. Now we are past one hurdle. Let's just keep solving for r of theta like it was an unknown value and see where it leads us. Eventually we do end up with r of theta isolated, but how do we make sense of this? We have that r of theta is equal to this expression times the derivative of r of theta. This expression is just a constant since k is a constant. So we have a function that is a multiple of its derivative. Or said another way, the derivative is a constant multiple of the function. What functions do we know of where the derivative is a constant multiple of the original function? They are exponential functions. Anything of the form a equals e to the bx has this property. But since we're dealing with thetas, we should probably write it as a times e to the b theta. If we pick k as 1/4, then b, which is the exponent, would be about 0.266. If we set a equal to 1, then graph the polar curve, we do see that it is a spiral that could be close to the disk spiral. But now, how do we go from the disk spiral to the one we actually see on the t-shirt? Well, we can think of generating the spiral on the t-shirt by unwinding the cut disk spirals. When we color a section, the edge of the segment is a straight line that cuts across a lot of disk spirals. Now we unwind those until these spirals become spokes again. Since r of theta is the distance from the center to the cut, when unwound, it will be scaled to r of theta divided by k, and it will be placed at negative theta since we're winding in the opposite direction. So if the disk spiral, r of theta, is this expression, then the spiral we see on the shirt will be this expression. Now let's check to see how well this model fits a real shirt. We can make some sliders for the different values and include another parameter that allows us to rotate it, and we can see that we can get a very good fit. We can even see that the value of b is close to our predicted value. Here's an image of a tight-eyed sheet. It has more turns before it leaves the sheet, and the model we came up with still fits quite well. This kind of spiral has a name. It's called a logarithmic spiral, and it is one of the most amazing curves in the world of mathematics. Logarithmic spirals are often found in nature, and shells are one of the most notable. Why do logarithmic spirals end up in nature? Because it's the shape that emerges when rolling up a wedge on itself. A snail shell is basically a cone rolled up. So cool, or maybe who cares? Knowing that the tight-eyed spiral is a logarithmic spiral is not really earth-shattering. Well, something was still bothering me about this problem. I can see the wedges or cones rolled up on each other making the spiral, but why does a flat surface like a t-shirt or sheet end up with a spiral? While an undergraduate and I were working on this problem, we found something really cool. If you print logarithmic spirals on a piece of paper and bend the paper along the spirals, alternating between up and down bends, then the paper cinches up nicely into a column or disk. This is much like what happens when winding up the t-shirt. So what we found is that the logarithmic spiral curves are the natural creases to winding up a flat sheet of material. We experimented a little more and found complementary logarithmic spirals allowed us to chop up a stiff surface into joints so that it could easily twist and untwist. I happened to know an engineering professor from across campus that was doing some work with origami designs to solve some engineering problems, and I thought he'd be interested in what we found. We met, and he said that this might solve a problem that they're having with a satellite solar array design. One of his doctoral students was working on a solar array project, and you can see from the image that there is a spiral in this design, but to get it to twist up and fit into a rocket and then untwist, they had to make the joints quite loose, which was causing them problems. I don't know if they used our design or not, but about a year later, some NASA scientists came to campus and presented their new design for a satellite solar array. It was our exact design. The professionals at NASA had figured out what two amateurs had figured out just by exploring a problem that seemed to have no practical application. So what should we learn from this experience? One thing is to lean into your curiosity and just see where it takes you, because it might take you somewhere out of this world. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.